time series analysis, a very important topic. And the reason it is important is that very recently we had a PhD in our, actually in my group, who did mobile video modeling, and he used time series modeling, and I was kind of felt bad that it is not in the book. And he had to read so many other places to find it. So you may use it as you see. So we'll talk about what is a time series. Then there are different models for time series called autoregressive, moving average, integrated, ARMA, ARIMA, SARIMA, FARIMA, and all those things. So we will talk about those. All right. So we will. What is a time series? Time series is actually, the name is a stochastic process. We have already seen stochastic processes before in queuing theory, but time series is actually a term which is much more used in practical sense than in statistic sense. And so any observation that you take over a period of time is a time series. For example, if you monitor the price of a stock on every day, that's a time series. For example, log the index, market index, that is a time series. If you mark the sizes of the video frames, that is a time series. Size of the packets over networks, that is a time series. Number of queries, of the number of bytes of the queries to a database system, that's a time series. Number of arrivals, active virtual machine in a cloud, that would be a time series. So any random number that can be continued over time. So time series is any series of numbers. If you are here working on sensor networks, you are taking sensor readings, those are time series. So what we need to do is, we need to develop a model for such series so that we can do resource allocation and improve the user experience. If we can, we figure it out as to how this series works, then we can do better. I mean, make better money in the stock market, or, you know, we can design better videos, whatever is the series for. So simplest model, one simplest model is what we call autoregressive model. In the autoregressive model, you forecast the next value as a linear function of the previous value. So x hat t is a0 plus a1 times xt minus 1. So we know yesterday's price, we know yesterday's observation, and we can forecast the today's price as a linear function of yesterday's price, a0 plus a1. And so here x hat is the best estimate given the whole past history. We not only know yesterday's price, we know the whole year's price, or we know the whole year's worth of observations. But we are assuming somehow that this is some kind of Markov process where knowing the yesterday's price is good enough, and we don't need to know the rest of the history. And if just knowing one is good enough, then this model will work. Okay? And this is called autoregressive because all we are doing is doing a regression. We are doing actually a linear regression. And auto means on itself. So rather than y being regressed on x, x is regressing on x. All right. So regression on itself, now there will be askers will be error. At the end of the day, you will find out what the xt is. So xt minus x hat t, and the one that you forecasted in the morning, that is difference is called the error. And so your model is xt is equal to a0 plus a1 xt minus 1 plus et. All right. And your goal is to find the best value for a0 and a1, and that will minimize the sum of squares of errors, SSE. So we have done all of this before, and we should be able to apply all those techniques here for autoregression. So we had linear regression, but now we have autoregression. Here's an example. So these are 50 disk accesses, number of disk accesses for the 50 database queries. The first query generated 73 disk accesses, second one 67, then 83, then 53, and there are 50 numbers in there. All right? And we want to figure out how much the next query will generate. And so we do the regression, and we know how to do regression, so I'm not taking you there. Basically, for the regression, we need all these sums, you know, like sigma of x, sigma of y, sigma of x and y, sigma of x squared, and so on and so forth. So we calculated all of those numbers here, except that n is 49, not 50. Why 49? Because you cannot, basically, when you want to do y1, you don't have y, sorry, when you want to do x0, x1, you don't have x0, because x is only starts from x1 through x50. So only you have 49 observations that you can use. You start with x2. X2 is equal to a0 plus a1 x1. You know x1. And x3 is equal to so on and so forth. So you can go all the way to 50, and you will find that you have 49 equations, not 50 equations. Even though there are 50 observations, the equations start from x2 in this case, because the observations start from x1. All right? So we have 49 observations, and your summation is from t equal to 2 to 50. You see, because you want to calculate xt to xt minus 1, you really, the lowest you can go is 1, which means t equal to 2. So all the summations here, all the summations, just to keep you informed, we keep all the summations from t equal to 2 to 50, and the number of, and the n that you use is 49. So this is the only trick. Don't forget this trick. The number of observations is 50, but in your calculation, you will use, if you had a formula which required n observations, you will use n is equal to 49, because you are going to lose one observation. You cannot predict x1. Once you have done that, then the rest is very straightforward. You find a0. You can go back into chapter 14 and look up the formulas. And a1. And you will find that the sum of the squared errors is 32,000, which is the lowest possible for any a0 or a1. Of course, everything else applies. Everything that we learned in the regression applies here. So a0 and a1, because there's an error, you can calculate the standard deviation of errors. And then you can calculate the confidence intervals of the regression parameters. You can calculate the confidence intervals of the predictions, right? So everything that we learned in the regression chapter applies here. All right, now I want to introduce another concept, which we have done it before, but just one more time, is what is a stationary process. So each random process that we have, actually, it turns out that if you were to redo it or do it another instance of it, it will be totally different, right? So here what I have done is I have shown a random process as a function of time. You can see the time axis and the value xt axis. So one curved line is actually one realization. If you were to do it another place for another stack, I mean actually not maybe another stack, but for some other thing which is similar, let's say you are doing sensor networks. So you, at one sensor, you observed one process. At the second sensor, you observed a second process. At the third sensor, for the same application. Or maybe it is a different movie, or it is a different scene in the movie. You will get a totally different sequence. Right? So the random, the sequence is random not only in time, but also in space. What do we mean by space? If you take a particular time and take these 50 realizations, you get 50 random numbers. And those 50 random numbers have a distribution, a density function, a mean, and the average, a mean, and the variance, and everything else, right? Just at one time t. So the question is, if you did this at time t, and you found out that this is normally distributed, then you went to time t plus 1, and then you found out that this is not exponentially distributed, you went to time t plus 2, and then you found out this is informally distributed, that would be very confusing. Right, very difficult to analyze. So the most of the things that we analyze, we assume that they are stationary. That means as we change the time, the behavior doesn't change. So if we do at time t equal to 50, and we find out that these numbers are informally normally distributed with mean of 5, we go to t equal to 1, t equal to 51, we would get the same mean, same normal distribution. That makes life much easier. If we assume that the distribution does not change with time, that is called a stationary process. Why stationary? Means it is not moving. It is moving randomly, but really this distribution is not moving. Distribution is not changing. So that word stationary simply means it is stationary in time. And so all the things that we are going to talk today, we are going to assume stationarity in most of. Actually, there's last part that we talk about non-stationarity. But the thing that we just discussed a minute ago, for example, autoregressive process, that we assumed stationarity, but we didn't tell you that. And so we are going to assume stationarity all the way through. And stationarity means not like the same distribution. It also means the same parameters for the distribution. In fact, it means more than that. It means that if you take any two time frames, xt and xt plus k, the joint distribution will not depend upon t. If you take any time t minus 1, t minus k, and so on and so forth, the joint distribution, all of those things, will not depend upon t. Maximum, it can depend upon the k. It can depend upon the difference, time difference, but not on the absolute time. Okay? So that is the definition of stationary process. Now, what other assumptions have been made in this one? So like any linear regression, we have made an assumption that this is a linear relationship between successive values. All right, it could be multiplicative, it could be exponential, it could be anything. But we have assumed here a linear regression, linear relationship. Then we have assumed that the errors are normal, independent, and identically distributed. Then only we can find out the confidence interval. If they're not normal, then we don't know the formula for confidence interval. All right? And so we have assumed normal errors, we have assumed independent errors, and then we have assumed additive errors. So we have assumed that ET adds to whatever we had before. And then we have assumed that XT is a stationary process. So we need to test all of these, and so the tests are very similar to what we have before, that you can check out for the linearity. And here is for those 50 numbers. These 50 numbers have plotted XT as a function of XT minus 1. Actually, if you didn't, I didn't plot the line, you will not be really able to say linearity, but with the line, it looks somewhat linear, right? It doesn't look like parabolic or anything else, so it looks linear. Error versus predicted value, X hat T. So we do that in the next slide. Error versus X hat T, that looks like randomly distributed. It doesn't look like there is a trend there. Then we go back to the third one, normality. We do the QQ plot. QQ plot looks a straight line. Very good, excellent. Then we go to, then there are other ways for plotting. You can plot ET as a function of T to check stationarity. What this means is that if you plotted errors as a function of time and you see a trend, then you know that the model does not apply for all the time. So we plotted ET as a function of T, and we don't see much trend here. It is just randomly distributed everywhere. So we checked, and then finally we also checked for correlation for independence. So we take the correlation between the errors, ET and ET minus 1, and so on and so forth. We plot the correlation, and I have not plotted for this sequence, but I will show you the correlation at the end. So you do those five tests to make sure that your assumptions are all valid. Now, it turns out that you do not have to stop at one value. You could take last p values, and then your model would be xt is equal to a0 plus a1 xt minus 1 plus a2 xt minus 2 plus a3 xt minus 3 plus ap xt minus p plus et. So you are going to take the last 1 month of data and predict forecast tomorrow, or you can take last 1 year of data and forecast tomorrow. You can do whatever you want, you know, with how many numbers you want. And if you use p values as shown here, t minus 1 through t minus p, then it is called ARP model, autoregressive model of the pth order. The order p is the number of terms that you have used on the right. So for example, AR2 model will simply use the last two values, xt is equal to a0 plus a1 xt minus 1 plus a2 xt minus 2 plus et. AR3 will use last three values, xt is equal to a0 plus a1 xt minus 1 plus a2 xt minus 2 plus a3 xt minus 3 plus et. So now you can, and you use multiple regression as before. There is nothing new here. You are going to use multiple regression formula, use the matrix multiplications, and you will be able to calculate A0 through A3. All right, we move on to the next one then. Basically, it is easier to deal with these things if we can introduce this backward shift operator. What backward shift operator does is BXT simply becomes, when you apply B to XT, you get XT minus 1. When you apply B to XT two times, it becomes XT minus 2. When you apply three times, it becomes XT minus 3. When you apply K times, it becomes XT minus K. And therefore, ARP model can be written as XT minus A0 minus A1 XT minus 1 and so on and so forth. In terms of B's, we can write BXT, B square XT, B raised to PXT, and then we can take out XT and we can get a polynomial in B. And that polynomial can be called phi. So phi P of B times XT equal to ET. This is the ARP model. So the notation is, whenever I say phi p of b xt, that means that there are p plus 1 actually parameters. They are a0 through ap, which are part of that polynomial. And, you know, and then basically you can write it in a short form now. So now, let's show you how to estimate the parameters for ARP. It's very easy, just as before. I think this is a repeat of what we did in multiple linear regression. You calculate SSE, which is sum of the squared errors. So for example, for AR2, you will put this, here's what you do for AR2. You can write down XT minus A0 minus A1 XT minus 1 minus A2 XT minus 2 whole square raised to 2. There's no T at the end, by the way. So 2 is squared, and then you add up from T equal to 3 to N. Remember, here is another interesting to notice. Because you need XT minus 2 and the lowest you have is 1, T has to start at 3. Since T has to start at 3, how many such equations you have? How many error terms you have? N minus 2, right? Say n is equal to 3, then you will have just one observation. So n minus 2 observations you will have. So you have n minus 2 terms. Now, if you want to find out the A0, A1, A2 that minimize SSE, all you have to do is differentiate with those values and put them to 0. And so we have done that. Differentiate with A0, differentiate with A1, differentiate with A2, set them to 0. We can write them down as a matrix equation. And then we can just invert this matrix and calculate A0. All right? So here's an example. Now, we take the same data that we had before and we fit an AR2 model. So, the AR2 model basically requires all these sums we calculated. Now, for n minus 2, we put 48. Basically, I mean, you know, that is the number of terms. And then we put all these sums and we do the inversion. I did this in Excel actually. And that thing that Michael sent out, that matrix thing, was very helpful. So keep that, you know, in your reference file someplace, because sometimes you forget how to manipulate matrix. But anyway, now the errors, the sum of squared errors is 31,969, which is 3% lower than AR1 model. So this model is 3% better. Is this worth the trouble? It's up to you. All right. Previously it was 32,995. Now it is 31,969. So by introducing another parameter, you have gained 3%. So now what are the assumptions? Actually, the assumption list is exactly the same. So I think it is just a repeat. And therefore, the tests are exactly the same. Basically, you are assuming linear relationship. And now the problem is the linear relationship is difficult to see in the three dimension. In one dimension, it was much easier to see. But and the normality and the independence and the additivity, stationarity, everything is same. So we are not going to go through that. Now we are going to just, actually we also know this word, but we are going to revisit this thing, autocorrelation. And that is important in the case of time series, because let's say you have two variables, XT and XT minus K. Normally we would call that covariance of them, but here we will call them autocovariance because they are the same variables, X. same series. So when you take two numbers from the same series, which are k apart, and you take the variance of them, you call it auto covariance at lag k. K is the lag. If you take t and t minus 1, the lag is 1. If you take t and t minus 2, the lag is 2. So you can calculate the auto covariance, and if you divide this by variance, you get the auto correlation. Okay? And since the time series is stationary, and that's what we have assumed, we know that any property will depend only upon the difference of the time, not on the time, absolute time. So if you take t and t minus k, the covariance will depend only upon k. The correlation will depend only upon k. The variance will depend only upon k, things like that, right? So now we will call it rk. R sub k is the autocorrelation at lag k, which simply is that you do the covariance between xt and xt minus k and divide it by the variance for xt and xt minus xt, just xt. And the good thing about the correlation is that it is bounded between 0 and 1, actually minus 0 and minus plus 1. And so the thing is, autocorrelation is dimensionless. While the covariance has a dimension which is square of the dimension of x, autocorrelation is dimensionless, so it is very easy to, and it is also limited to minus 1 to plus 1. So we can easily see that what is the correlation. What is the, how much is the correlation, how much is the dependence. In the case of, basically it has been shown that under those assumptions that we have made, that everything is linear and so on and so forth, the autocorrelation would be normally distributed with a mean of 1 minus upon n and with a variance of minus 1 upon n. And therefore you can calculate the confidence intervals for the autocorrelation, which will be, now the confidence intervals are based upon the square root of variance, so square root of n. So you have minus 1 plus minus 1.96. Where does 1.96 come from? Yeah, right. For 95% confidence interval, if you go to the Z table, you will find the number 1.96. So the statistician actually don't even use 1.96, they just use 2. And they don't use the first term because first term is too small, n is large generally. And so square root of n is small, and so we just use the second term. And so the confidence interval basically is minus plus 2 upon square root of n. All right? So everybody understands how we come up with this term, minus plus 2 upon square root of n. First, we get rid of the mean, which is there, but not, you know, very small. And second, we round up 1.96 to 2. So basically, whatever correlation you get, you just add plus minus 2 upon square root of n. If it crosses 0, we know that that correlation is 0. Actually, we don't do that. What we do is, we draw a line around 0. We draw a line around 0, which is plus minus 2 upon square root of n. If any correlation comes, touches, or is inside that boundary, then we say that that correlation is 0. Because if it is inside that boundary, it will certainly cross 0. So you will see that in a minute. Now, I'm going to use a term called white noise. And nowadays, the way we are, we have to every time justify the color. Why white? So I went on to find out what is white about white noise. All right? And so let me explain to you. Errors are normally distributed and have a zero mean and variance. So such sequences which are normally distributed and have a zero mean and variance and which are identical, independent, are called white noise sequences. All right? The white noise has the following property. The mean value is 0 for all t. The variance is sigma square for all t. The covariance is sigma square for k equal to 0. Means, even if you take t and t minus 1, they are not correlated. T and t minus 2 are not correlated. For all k's, they are 0. Except for k equal to 0, which means by itself. So what that means is that if you were to plot the autocorrelation function for white noise, it will be an impulse function at 0. And an impulse in 0, some of you know Laplace transform, and you know that if you have an impulse, the Laplace transform is a unit function. And that means in the time domain, if you have an impulse, in the frequency domain, it's a unit function. That means it has constant value for all frequencies. And so these people, actually, many of these, we haven't gotten into the frequency spectrum of random numbers, but statisticians talk about spectrums. And so basically white noise has a flat spectrum. And the term when the white noise was invented, it was not invented in terms of random numbers, it was invented for the light signals and the noise. And they assumed that the noise, which has the same spectrum all over, is white because the white light has that spectrum. Actually, it turns out since then we have learned that white light actually does not have that spectrum. White light is a sum of red, blue, and green that we didn't know at that time. All right? So it's actually white noise does not have that spectrum, but the name has stuck. Because of that white light, this is called white noise. And so I will need this term as I introduce you here, okay? If you want to read more about white noise, then you can read this Wikipedia article. Anyway, so an example of white noise would be if we fit a model which says XT is equal to V0 plus ET, where we say that the signal that I'm getting from my sensor or from my stock market is a white noise, means it has only V0 and everything else is noise. V0 is simply the mean and everything else is a noise. If you do that, you will fit a model, the errors will pass the normality test, your SSE will be 43702.08. So this is your bottom line basically. You are comparing your prediction with this. If you from 43,000, you bring it down to 33,000, you have improved 25%. You can say, well, look, from the total white noise, I brought down my unpredictability, uncertainty by 25%, right? And then when I went from AR1 to AR2, I brought it down another 3%, right? So white noise is your basic norm. You should be able to do better than white noise. And white noise assumes that there is no predictability whatsoever, except for the mean. All right, now we can extend this white noise to a little bit more. We can say, well, let's do this. Let's take not just one noise, we should take maybe last three errors, and do that, input in the model. So we take a moving window. If these are the error values which are shown by solid lines on the top, then you take three values, and then you take the average of them somehow, with a linear function of them, and then you put them in the model that is called moving average model. So moving average of the order 1 will be simply XT is equal to B0 plus ET plus B1 times ET minus 1. All right, we have just taken ET minus 1 and added to the previous one. So actually white noise model is simply MA0, zeroth order moving average model. Now we have the first order. First order includes ET minus 1. If we add ET minus 2, that is the moving average model of order 2. If we add up to Q, then that is moving average model of order Q. And 0 is already shown, 0 is simply ET. Anyway, so these are all different moving average models. And so this is another popular model for time series. In general, you can write it in terms of the P parameter that we talked about before. So BXT minus B0 can be written as ET plus B1 times B times ET and B applied to ET and so on and so forth. And then you can take out ET and you get a polynomial in B called psi sub Q, and this should not be D, this should be a B in there, okay? Just change that D to P. So that is a polynomial of order Q. And that is a moving average model. Now, to calculate moving average parameter is difficult. So, let's just show you an example why it is so difficult. So, we want to fit XT is equal to B0 plus ET plus B1 ET minus 1. Now, the thing is, we cannot use simple regression. Why not? Because we don't know ETs. In the autoregressive model, we knew XTs. But in this case, we don't know ETs. If we don't know ETs, ETs depend upon B0 and B1, and B0, B1 depend upon ETs. So there is this circular dependence. And therefore, the only way to find it is by iteration. You assume some value for B0, B1, calculate all the errors, calculate the sum of the squared errors, then you change B0, B1, calculate sum of the squares again. If it is lower, then go in the same direction. If it is higher, go in the opposite direction. So you keep moving until you find the lowest value. This is kind of painful, but I went through that process yesterday, and I will show it to you in Excel. So basically, for the data that we had, we want to fit B0, B1, and we know that the mean is 67.72. So it looks reasonable to start with B0 is equal to 67.72, and I just randomly selected B1 is equal to 0.4, just randomly selected. Then I did compute all the errors using that model, and I calculated the sum of squared errors, and I was kind of surprised that the errors didn't add up to zero, and the sum of the squares came out to 33,000, which was a good number, better than 43,000. So then I adjusted B0 and B1. So let me show you how I adjusted it. First, actually, I started with three values, 0.4, 0.5, and 0.6, three values for B1. And then I compared them and I found 0.5 is the lowest. So that's good. We have to be somewhere between 4 and 6, near 5. So now I'm going to try 5.5 and 4.5. So I tried 5.5 and 4.5. And I found out that the 4.5 is the lowest. So now I have to find out something between 4, 5, and then the other two values. So I did 0.475 and 4875. Now 475 is lowest. So then I tried 465 and 475 happens to be the lowest. But then I said, well, I really don't like this non-zero mean. So I adjusted this B0 parameter a little bit. And actually, I found this is where I get the lowest E bar, E0 mean. So this is what the values are. All right. But I had to do, you know, these many iterations, and each iteration is kind of difficult, right? Although it's not that difficult. Once you have set up your Excel worksheet, all you have to do is copy the column with a different value. I keep copying. And so with that, we get that value, and I will stop right here, actually, and the next time we will continue on this analysis. But you can see, for autoregressive models, determining the parameter is trivial. For moving average model, determining the parameter is quite a pain. However, there is something else which is good about it, and that's why people use it, that we will talk about next time. All right, now you can read any book on time series analysis in the library. I had a book here, I don't know. Okay, let me see. One of the books that I liked is by Chris Chatfield. C-H-A-T-F-I-E-L-D. Although this material is not from that book, but among all the books that I kind of read, I found that that was the easiest, the best in some sense. So you can read it there in the next edition of my book. This will all be there. Yeah, because see 0.475 in the fifth line. Let me see. Fifth line is 0.45. And then because it is between 4.5 and 0.45 and 0.5, so we get to 4.75. And then I would have gone one more step, but it turns out 4.75 is the lowest. So then I just did around 4.75. Basically, you're doing some kind of binary search, except that you found that you went into the right direction, then you don't have to try the other direction. I mean, you're just trying to find the minimum. And if you found that you're going in the right direction, then you go more in that same direction. So maybe, I mean, there must have been a value that I didn't try, which I was supposed to try, but I think I tried almost all possible values. And actually, if somebody wrote in a programming language, then you can write a program that will just go through and find the minimum. But I just did it manually on Excel worksheet. So each of these values, as you can see, are within 0.1% of each other, because 33,000 is the value, and the first two digits are all same. It's just in the hundreds that the difference is. So it shouldn't really matter too much, you know, which value we select here. But just for the sake of optimization, we did that. Yeah, so the thing is, yeah, basically, I didn't need to go there, because what happened was I found out that 4-5 was the lowest, and therefore I went to 4-7-5 and 4-2-5, but 4-7-5 was lower, so then I didn't go the other direction. That was the decision at that point. At that point, and the fifth line, I wanted to try 4-2-5. But by the time I reached 4-7-5, I said, oh, well, this is the direction to go, not there, not the other way around. See, because we are assuming this is, the whole thing is basically, you know, like, has a dip.